Hi, this is Richard Blade, the voice of SiriusXM's First Wave, and you're listening to the voice of 91 Reasons, Jeff Tucker. Totally awesome.
You're listening to 91 Reasons, a journey into the twisted landscape of pop culture. Keep your hands and arms inside the podcast at all times. And now, the voice, Jeff Tucker.
Hey everybody, Scary Farm is kicking my butt, just like everybody else. This event is all-encompassing, it's huge, and it just takes its toll on you. So I think the cycle we've been on is that every time Scary Farm comes back around, the show output gets a little wacky. What sucks is I recorded a whole show last night with Rachel and Austin. And I don't know what the heck happened, but the audio is full of this huge buzzing noise, which I can't get rid of. So we'll have to do that episode again, which is, it sucks because you're trying to replicate spontaneity. You know, it's like that scene in Groundhog Day when he has the snowball fight for the second time. And you can tell that it's so forced and not off the cuff, you know, a snowball fight. You know, it's just interesting. So instead, you know, I have 10 or 15 episodes that are always in the back of my mind, percolating ideas for episode. I'll be doing one. I wanted to do today one on Black Mirror, which is this Netflix show I've been watching, but I'm not finished with all the episodes, and I want to be able to finish them all before I talk about the series, and in particular, one of the episodes. That truly profound episode, but that'll be in the future. Instead, as you can tell by the title, we're going to begin what's probably going to be more than one episode, talking about the films of Pixar. Now, I did, early in the run of 91 Reasons, I did the best of DreamWorks, which was an odd thing because I don't like much of anything DreamWorks has put out. DreamWorks is now pretty much defunct, but for a while they had a huge run with big, big animated movies. You know, Shrek and Shrek 2 were some of the biggest, if not for a time, the biggest animated movies of all time. Like, that's a huge thing. And I'm a big Mike Myers fan, but I just don't like, there's something about the DreamWorks aesthetic, which is odd because it's the Katzenberg aesthetic, and Katzenberg walked away from Disney, so I get all that. I would guess the newest other Pixar is Blue Sky over at Fox. And then, what is it at Universal? I don't know. I just know it's, every time you see them, it's Minions. Minions this and Minions that. And I'm going to do another I Don't Get It episode that's Minions-centric. Because, man, there's something I don't get. But, hey, we're not talking about that today. We're talking about the films of Pixar. We're going to go chronologically from date of release. I'm a huge Pixar fan. I think they quickly rose to be the gold standard of animation. I do think that it's sad that Disney itself, instead of identifying that the reason the Pixar movies are so popular is story and not format. And Disney was very quick to shut down its hand-drawn animation wing in favor of computer-generated movies. And that's unfortunate because, you know, the hand-drawn animation film began with Walt Disney and Snow White. And they were the creators, the perfectionists of it. It was their baby. And to have it go out, like snuffed out like a candle, because they don't think kids will watch that is so ridiculous. You know, you put on Snow White, kids will watch it. You put on The Jungle Book, kids will watch it. 101 Dalmatians, Cinderella, Sleeping Beauty, Lilo and Stitch. You know, kids will watch this. It's about story and character. It's not about medium. You know, Clerks is a good movie because of the story and the characters, because on film it looks like a mess. You can see that it was made for 25 cents, but that doesn't matter because the heart is in it and the drive to tell a good story is in there. And before The Frog Princess, or The Princess and the Frog, I think that was the release title, but the original title was The Frog Princess, Disney went out on Home on the Range, which is a movie most people have never even heard of, because they thought that computer animation was the only thing kids would watch, because that's what I'd like to say Saturday morning, but you know, Saturday morning TV was killed by the government years ago in the 90s. But like the Disney Channel and Nickelodeon, they went a long way on computer animated shows, which is bizarre because Nickelodeon's most popular show of all time is SpongeBob hand-drawn animation. Hand-drawn animation will never die. As long as people want to tell good stories, it doesn't matter the medium. And it's not as if kids won't watch a certain medium over another. Kids are drawn like adults to good stories and characters that we care about. And that's just, you know, that's how mankind began, around the campfire, telling stories and sharing experiences and myths and fables. But, you know, we're talking about Pixar. Now, I was a Pixar fan before I knew what Pixar was, because I was a member of the Lucasfilm fan club. It was the Star Wars fan club. And then when Star Wars ended, they turned it into the Lucasfilm fan club, and they would send out these magazines, and the magazines showcased what ILM was working on. And ILM had all these different branches, and one of them was a computer graphics division that was founded by Steve Jobs. And yeah, I'm telling the short story. You can get the longer story. Go read it on Wikipedia. But Steve Jobs and George Lucas were the driving force behind the money to make Pixar a reality. The first computer-generated character to appear in a film was the Knight in Young Sherlock Holmes, 1985. Bizarre movie. I enjoy it. I think it's underrated. And that scene was what got us to the theater, to see something we had never seen before. A stained glass character leap off of the glass and taunt a character. And the people that did that eventually became Pixar. They'd worked on these small animated shorts, Wall-E B. I remember seeing Wall-E B as stills in the Lucasfilm magazine and just like, that's made on a computer. That's unbelievable looking. And we knew it was going to be the wave of the future. Us nerds did. You know, we saw Starfighter. And how all the ships were done computer graphics. The rudimentary computer graphics merged with the hand-drawn graphics of Tron. The morphing technique used in Willow. You know, there were all these different breakthroughs. And they were one at a time. And they were usually the centerpiece of whatever film that was coming out to showcase that. And as a film buff, I went to these movies to see these things. You know, there were groundbreaking effects that leapt off the screen. You know, they seem quaint by today's standard. I mean, they really do, because you're like, oh, that's a terrible effect, but put it in its time frame and it's magic. You know, the time travel sequence from Star Trek IV, The Voyage Home, computer graphics, so many others, the digital work in Roger Rabbit that is invisible, the digital work in Back to the Future 2 and 3 that is invisible, that you don't, they're so good you don't see it. The digital work in Forrest Gump, you know, when people who didn't know who Gary Sinise was were convinced that the scenes of him with legs were special effects and the scenes of him without legs were not special effects, but rather that's how he was. And it was a shock to see him on red carpet walking. But I watched all those, you know. Look at the digital effects in Death Becomes Her. You know, another Zemeckis film where he said, look, we're going to push the envelope here of what digital effects can do. It's hard to describe to a young person what it was like in 1994 to go see The Mask and see computer graphics being used on a human being and to turn the already rubbery Jim Carrey into an even rubberier Stanley Ipkiss putting his mask on, you know. And it's interesting that I'm old enough to have gone through the entire gamut of watching computer graphics grow up on screen, from, you know, hand-drawn vector graphics in 2001 to fake digital graphics in movies like Looker, if you've ever seen Looker by Michael Crichton, and how they kind of fudged all that. I mean, one of my favorites is Escape from New York, where the digital graphics of the vector graphic city of New York isn't anything to do with a computer, and instead is a actual model of New York City with glow-in-the-dark strips made to look like a computer screen. I mean, that's truly amazing. You say, look, we only have this amount of money, and we want this to appear on screen, and very smart, crafty people make it happen. And I've watched the documentaries on Pixar, and it's an amazing story of people who wanted to push the envelope and were willing to sacrifice their personal lives in exchange for revolutionizing the way stories are told. And Lasseter and his team, if you've ever seen we take it for granted now with a smartphone in our hand and a flat screen monitor on our desk, but computers used to be big, bulky, giant, and the bigger they were, the less they did. They were ridiculous. And I've seen images of what they used to render Toy Story and how, oh my gosh, it's a wonder it ever got made. It took hundreds of hours to get a single few frames of Toy Story completed. And that's a case where, unlike today, like, it's so weird today. I was just watching the making of Ready Player One and how Steven Spielberg has this camera that can show you the virtual world of the, because they're filming on a green screen. There's nothing practical, but he can just move the camera around and see in a virtual world all the set pieces and move them. Just move them. Oh, I'm going to move this here. This building, move that building over there. Okay, sure, Steve. And with a few keystrokes, it's all done. And it didn't used to be like that. It used to be you started with the script and you didn't start a moment of filming, usually, until your script was as tight as it could be and told the story you wanted with the emotional resonance that you needed to tell that story. If you want to see an example of an animated movie's whole different ball game. Because with a live action film, you can throw out a sequence and go film it again. With an animated sequence, you start throwing stuff out. You're looking at a sequence that took 6 months for somebody to animate. And when Katzenberg took over Disney, he started tinkering with The Black Cauldron. And there's a movie that was in complete trouble because they didn't have a polished script, and instead they just started making a movie. And in the end, Katzenberg had all these pieces, but he didn't have a coherent movie. So Lasseter and team couldn't make that mistake. They didn't have enough money or backing by the studio to make that mistake. What they had was Katzenberg before he left, because, you know, Toy Story was in production for many years, but they had Michael Eisner, who kept trying to make movies to appeal to teenagers. And if you've ever seen the original hand-drawn storyboards for Toy Story, it's a completely different movie. Woody is a complete a-hole who gets his comeuppance at a much friendlier Buzz Lightyear. And the dynamics of Woody being the stalwart cowboy hero that Andy needs, and Buzz being the future of action figures that Andy wants, somehow coming to terms with their limitations is not in that script. As a writer, it's difficult to jettison the stuff that you've worked on and to start over. But Pixar's never had that problem. They don't mind saying, look, let's stop and we'll start over, because we can't animate this on the computer until we know what we want. Because do you really want to render a couple of scenes over a 2-week period only to realize that they've been cut from the script? No. That's why it's important to storyboard a movie like Toy Story and really nail it in that format so that everybody gets it before you start creating the scenes in the computer. And the reason I say all that is I go to the movies a lot. You know that. Not so much lately. I've been too darn busy. This was, to me, a pretty lackluster summer other than Ready Player One and Infinity War. Most of it was unwatchable movies. But there have been summers where there's an embarrassment of riches. Toy Story wasn't a summer release. It was a Thanksgiving release. But seasons of good movies. I'll never forget going to see Toy Story. We had seen the trailer, and the trailer blows you away because this is a movie that when it came out didn't look like anything you'd ever seen. I'd watched Transformers Beast Wars on TV where everything was shiny and awful. I'd watched Reboot, where that was the first computer animated show for kids. I collected all the figures from Reboot because, you know, I'm a collector. But I'd never seen anything like Toy Story. And the reason they picked Toy Story toys, I mean, they had done Tin Toy as a short, where if you've ever seen the original version of Tin Toy, the toy parts look great. The baby is terrifying because they just couldn't get a human look. The computer just wouldn't do it. The computer was much more adept at shiny, hard surfaces, which is why they led with Toy Story, Bug's Life, and Toy Story 2 before they even thought about doing organic creatures. So Toy Story comes out Thanksgiving 1995. Rachel and I went and saw it on Thanksgiving Day. We had been together a few years. We'd been married. And we just had this thing of, let's not stay at home and have the traditional Thanksgiving with everybody else. Let's go to the movies. And we had planned to see two movies that day on Thanksgiving. We saw Casino, which is nearly 3 hours. And then we hopped over and saw Toy Story. And Casino is one of my favorite movies of all time, just because it's Goodfellas crossed with Las Vegas. And I love Las Vegas. But we went in to see Toy Story. And as the film unspooled, and remember, also, this is before digital cinema. So this is a digitally computer-created movie that then is transferred to actual film and then run on an actual film projector. You know, it seems so weird now where everything is digital. But, I mean, the theaters now, the film is just dialed in. You know, it comes in over the wire. Toy Story, the first film, was delivered in canisters as an actual physical movie. And at the end of Toy Story, something happened that I had never seen before. The audience applauded. It was so good, the audience applauded. That doesn't happen very often in movies. It happened in Back to the Future 3 because we all knew Robert Zemeckis, the director, and Bob Gale, the writer, were in attendance. So we wanted to show our support. If you go to a screening where somebody involved with the movie is there, they will applaud. But just a regular run-of-the-mill screening of a movie to have applause was bizarre. But we knew that Toy Story was something special. And it's something special not because of the way it looked. Yes, it looks amazing. Now, go back and look at it, and it's very crude, very crude looking. But it's the story that gets you. And they really, in that first film, they're really firing on all cylinders, because this is, and I, you know, I'm putting my own spin on it. I don't know exactly what was going on with Laster and Company, but to me, it looks as if these are some guys who thought to themselves, we're going to get one shot at this. We're going to get a studio like Disney to give us the money to make this bizarre one-off movie. And if we don't do it right, we're never going to get a chance to do it again. I know they had other ideas in the pipeline, but those were just pie-in-the-sky ideas until they proved that people would go see a computer animated movie, because at that point, no one had... I mean, it was as big a dare as Snow White was. You know, Walt, no one will sit through a over an hour-long cartoon that has sound. I'm going to try it there. You know, John Lasseter, no one will sit through what looks like an hour and a half special effect reel. Well, you know, if we tell a good enough story, they will. And tell a good story, they did. The story of Toy Story is fantastic. It's the insecurities of losing someone you love to what you perceive to be somebody better than you. It's the longing to not ever want things to change because they're perfect, but knowing that they have to change because that's the nature of life. You know, getting Tom Hanks and Tim Allen together, fantastic. The supporting cast, Don Rickles, and the guy from Princess Bride as Rex, great actor. Annie Potts as Little Bo Peep. You know, even Jim Varney as Slinky Dog. You know, if Woody says it's okay, then it's okay with me. You know, there's so many good things about Toy Story. It tells such a good story in such an interesting way that we had never seen before. That the first time you watch Toy Story, it's over in an instant, because it's so compelling and so good. And from a writing point of view, the things that it sets up pay off later. The things that people think are hindrances to their lives become the very thing that save them. I'm talking about Buzz's space dome. You know, he thinks it's silly at some point, but it's what lights the match at the end. You know, it's just such a stellar, stellar movie. And I remember I wasn't a guy that bought a lot of Disney movies in my 20s. My mom bought a lot of them. But I remember buying Toy Story and watching it a lot. You know, the screenplay by Joss Whedon, for God's sake. Joel Cohen. Toy Story is a masterpiece. And as far as I was concerned, they were never going to do any better than that film. You know, it's a perfect, perfect movie with, you know, Tom Hanks giving one of his best performances with just his voice. You know, hope you get a moving buddy. If you don't have a moving buddy, if you don't have one, get one. I don't want any toys left behind. I mean, it's so good and so quotable, and it brings you into its universe. It has its rules. They break the rules to get out of the situations that they're in, and feature so many amazing moments. You know, I love when Buzz has given up and he becomes Mrs. Nesbitt. One minute, you're to fill the whole galaxy. They say, you know, you're sucking down Darjeeling with Marie Antoinette and her little sister. Buzz, we have to go. I am not Buzz. I am Mrs. Nesbitt. Like, oh my God. And Mrs. Nesbitt, I think, is a callback to Arthur, where Bitterman tells Linda not to get out of the limousine because Mrs. Nesbitt deserves the entire treatment. But that's just me projecting onto the film. I saw Toy Story a couple times in a theater. I went to Disneyland for the Toy Story obstacle course where they strapped your feet to a base so you could be an army man and jump around like an army man. I bought a lot of the toys. I had a lot of Toy Story toys. But here's the thing, and this is how life intersects and intertwines with pop culture and culture itself, not just pop culture, but life itself. It's so weird how that works, because they wouldn't have another movie. You know, Pixar wouldn't have another movie for 3 years. It took them 3 years to get Bugs Life into theaters. Now, here's the thing. When Toy Story came out, no one was counting on it being anything other than a moderate hit. It was a huge, huge box office smash. It won its own special recognition Oscar for achievement in animation. It changed the rules, so to speak. Even though the Pixar animated, computer animated movies were still living in their own little niche. You know, none of the other studios wanted to pony up the cash to come up with a movie like that. It would take a while. It would take Ants. It would take them 3 years. So Katzenberg had left Disney, and the first computer animated movie he spits out is Ants, which is so like Bug's Life, it's ridiculous. Different plot, but about ants. Because, again, we can only do shiny stuff with computer graphics at this point. They can do grass and a few things here, and there's bird feathers. But as far as long-term and convincing, it's shiny surfaces only. Now, I knew I was going to like Bug's Life because it has Dave Foley as the lead, and I love Dave Foley from Kids in the Hall. He was my favorite actor on Kids in the Hall. So I was really surprised that he was going to be, you know, a big star. I mean, he had a big turn in news radio, but this is the big time. You know, you're now a forever Disney character. And the thing I was talking about life interceding is, by the time this movie comes out, I have gone from a naive newlywed to a father. I have a kid now. I have a kid who's a year and a half, and we're going to go see and take our kid to see Bug's Life. I mean, that's a big thing. Now I'm sharing this love of storytelling and characters with my son. And the thing that the studio did, they were not ready for Toy Story. So there wasn't a lot of merchandise at the time that the movie came out. You know, it's weird to think in the age of mass marketing the way we are now, that there were some missteps, and not having enough toys for Toy Story made Christmas 95, everybody wanted a Buzz Lightyear, and it had to talk just like the one in the movie, you know? And it's like, remember the movie Small Soldiers? They made only the monsters, the Gorgonites, but they didn't make the soldiers. And everybody wanted the soldiers. So the studios don't always get it right in merchandise. They pick something to focus on, and sometimes that's wrong. You know, I couldn't go see Last Jedi and then get a Luke Skywalker figure. It took months, you know, or Force Awakens. They just didn't think about it. But for Bug's Life, it was one of the biggest toy releases of all time. They had so many Bug's Life toys, giant talking flicks, action figure size flicks, bug size flicks with play sets, giant play sets. You name it, they made it for Bug's Life. Bug's Life instantly became a franchise brand of every kind of product imaginable. From toothpaste, to bedding, to toys, to Happy Meals. You name it, they had it. And we bought it all for our kid. We bought it all. We were all in. And by this time, the Toy Story toys had come full circle. So we were buying a lot of Pixar toys for our kid. Now, Bug's Life itself, the story is basically the Seven Samurai with bugs, you know. The bugs are doing their thing, and the grasshoppers don't want to work. They just want to steal from the bugs. So from the ants, and the ants are like, look, we have to get somebody to help us. So they send Flick out to find these warriors. And instead Flick hires a circus. It's got, Jonathan, what's his name from Lost in Space, as the magician. Oh dear. I'll try to help you, dear, but I'll try. Jonathan Harris, some great voice. Kevin Spacey as the bad guy. What's his name as the good grasshopper? He's a great actor. I think his name is Richard Kind. Yeah, Richard Kind. I was going to cheat and look on Wikipedia, but it's Richard Kind. Such good character voices. Dave Foley, Julia Louis-Dreyfus. And that was, this is the turn right here. This is the split. And the actual difference you can see between the Pixar movies and the DreamWorks movies. Because, you know, as a consumer, I don't have to pick. I can have both. If I have enough disposable income, I can have both. So, of course, we bought Ants for Luke. And I watched Ants a bunch of times, featuring the voice of Woody Allen, Sharon Stone, Sylvester Stallone, Christopher Walken. I'm an ant. Crazy. Like, and there's the split. And the split is Pixar is going to find who they think is the best voice for the character. Who brings this character to life. And there's no better observation than that than the late Joe Rampt, who voiced Heimlich. Because he was an animator on the movie. He worked on the film, and he was only doing the voice's temporary track till they found somebody else. And in the end, they said, look, you're the guy. You're doing it so well, we don't want anybody else to do it. And DreamWorks was like, what celebrity can we line up for these vocal roles? Who can we get? Sharon Stone? Done. Do the kids know who Sharon Stone is? Doesn't matter. Do the kids give a crap who Woody Allen is? Doesn't matter. I'm an ant. I'm so beside myself. Like, who? What? Woody Allen in a cartoon? Okay, sure. I'm a big Woody Allen fan. But my 1.5-year-old isn't. He just knows it's about talking bugs. And the bugs in Ant's life are bizarre looking. Totally bizarre looking. The ones in A Bug's Life are much softer, friendlier, gentle. And it's Dave Foley. You gotta love Dave Foley, man. So we went all in on Bug's Life, and we really enjoyed it. And we knew from the, you know, from entertainment reports that they were working on Toy Story 2. And Toy Story 2 was going to be a direct-to-video release, because Disney got in the habit of making these direct-to-video sequels just to cash in on them. You know, the first one was The Return of Jafar, and that just opened the floodgates. They had Dan Castellaneta do the voice of the genie, because Robin Williams wasn't going to do a direct-to-video movie, but it made a lot of money. The first Disney theatrical animated sequel was Rescuers Down Under. So they proved that they could take this roster of characters that they had, this stable of films, and just churn out cheap Jungle Book 2, cheap Lady and the Tramp 2, Lion King 2, Simba's Pride. The worst, in my opinion, being Lion King 1.5, which turns Timon and Pumbaa into Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, and sort of takes the majesty out of a lot of the Lion King movie. You don't have to take it as canon if you don't want to. But the idea that all of the animals were not bowing to Mufasa and his new child, Simba. Instead, they were fainting because Pumbaa farted. I mean, really? Really, guys? But as a guy who says, let's take a risk, I get it. You want to tell a story on the fringe sides? I totally get that. And Toy Story 2 was going to be a direct-to-video sequel. We were going to, of course we were going to buy it for our kid. Are you kidding? We couldn't wait. And instead, Pixar did the unthinkable. They tore the movie apart They fired the director. Lasseter took over and took the pieces that he had and reworked the movie. And advance word was that anytime they do that, especially, like I said earlier, especially on an animated movie, this is the kiss of death. You know, this is the Black Cauldron all over again. And instead, Toy Story 2 is reworked into a theatrical feature. So, okay, we will take our child to go see Toy Story 2. Okay, I had said Toy Story 2 is one of the greatest movies I've ever seen. I enjoyed Bug's Life. Toy Story 2 is a masterpiece. It is a masterpiece of storytelling. It does everything that a sequel should do. It reintroduces you to characters that you love. It offers new insight into those characters. We already knew who Buzz Lightyear of Star Command was. But finding out who Woody is and where Woody comes from was the real revelation. And the storyline of Jessie being abandoned by her owner and the Sarah McLachlan sequence alone will put you into a coma. It is so depressing. When Somebody Loved Me. You know, because the only dull spot in Toy Story is when Buzz tries to fly in Sid's house and the Randy Newman song, I Will Go Sailing No More, is playing. That to me is that's the low point. My wife loves that sequence. Rachel loves it. And I'm always like, oh, I'm going to the bathroom. I cannot watch this. But When Somebody Loved Me in Toy Story 2 will turn you into a puddle. And man, Toy Story 2 is good. Not only does it do all those things where, like, at the end of Toy Story 1, we were introduced to a puppy, Buster. In the new film, Buster's old and can't do much of anything. And you think he's going to tear the toys up. It's not. He plays with them like anybody else. And then they actually show something on screen that you never see in movies. You could count on both, like, there's less than 10. I bet if I tried, I couldn't even think of 10 examples of a garage sale, a yard sale in a movie. It's so darn rare. You know, the Will Ferrell movie, Everything Must Go, is about a yard sale. The Simpsons go to Professor Frink's yard sale. But that's such a rarity in movies. I don't know why. It's just never been one of those things they just do. You know, it's never a rummage sale in the movies. But Andy's mom is having a yard sale, and she comes in and she takes these toys away. And Woody gets caught up in it because he didn't get to go to cowboy camp. Like, there's so much darkness. Like, it's like Empire Strikes Back. And, there's this idea that we crave happy endings. And we do. As a people, we crave happy endings. But we only are satisfied if right before the happy ending is darkness beyond dark. Despair beyond despair. Darth Vader must reveal to Luke that he's his father in order for us to have the happy ending of Return of the Jedi. We have to have the dark, dark before the light. In Schindler's List, before the war ends, and we know the war will end, we have to take that train journey to Auschwitz. That to me is one of the most terrifying sequences ever put on film. And I hold my breath when I see it. I'm so scared. And when the war ends and Schindler's List of people are freed and Schindler himself is on the run, I cry like a baby at that sequence because we've gone through the darkness. And Toy Story's dark. It has a lot of dark. Toy Story 2 is dark, you know? They're going to be shipped away to Japan to be in a museum, for God's sake. They may never see Andy again. And everything's going to work out fine. And Prospector Pete is such a son of a bitch. You want to shake him. Oh my God, you want to shake him. But the movie itself is a masterpiece. Jessie's character is great. There's a snake in my boot. we finally get Al of Al's Toy Barn to be like the first fully integrated human character in these films. Because we'd seen Andy and his mom and Sid and his sister, but not to the extent that we see Al. Because they didn't know how to do it right. You know? And when Bullseye's licking the Cheeto crumbs, the cheese puff crumbs off of Al's finger, I mean, it looks photo real. Toy Story 2 is amazing. And we watched it a lot. We watched it two or three times in the theater. Because, you know, they released Bug's Life and Toy Story 2 were in theaters. And then, like, a month later, they added the goof scenes at the end. You know, the messed up scenes, the blunders, the bleeps and the bloops. So it encouraged you to go again because you got to see, you know, the fake microphone come down. And you got to see, in Toy Story 2 at least, Heimlich and Flick get thrown aside as Buzz is chopping through. We saw it a lot, you know. We got to meet Zurg. You know, I am your father. No! Good catch, son! I mean, you have to be supportive. I mean, so many amazing sequences in Toy Story 2. And the airport scene is exhilarating as a chase scene at the end. You know, you have to really, they amped up the finale. After, I mean, the first one's great in the moving truck. The second one has, they're at the airport. I mean, it's fantastic. Unbelievable film. Toy Story 2, again, it's a masterpiece of filmmaking. The next release would take 2 years. 2 years before Monsters, Inc. was released in theaters. Now, by this time, Luke is 4 years old. He is not an infant anymore. He is a young child. And this was the first film that he gravitated to, that he claimed as his own. And Christmas 2001 was all Monsters, Inc. We bought the Monsters, Inc. playset, the talking figures, the action figures. Luke had pajamas, blankets, all the Happy Meals. We were all in on Monsters, Inc., you know? And I rediscovered how much I liked Billy Crystal, because he's great in Monsters, Inc. Again, they're picking celebrities that fit the mold and not just for name value. Because by 2001, Billy Crystal's not a name anymore. He hasn't made a big movie in quite a while. He made those Analyze This and Analyze That. You know, but he's not a megastar like When Harry Met Sally anymore. Or City Slickers. I mean, those are great movies. And John Goodman, he had a really good film roster. But he was mostly known for Roseanne. But here he is as Sully, James P. Sullivan. And it's fantastic. This is continuing the mold of Bug's Life. Monsters, Inc. lives in that weird world where it's an alternate reality where it's just like the human world, but there's a lot of puns and clever ways that the monsters do things that mimic human behavior. Although there is the portals, the doors, into the human world. So you get both. And Monsters, Inc. is another film where Pixar, if you've ever seen the original DVD, and I think Monsters, Inc. might have been the first Pixar movie I bought on DVD. You know, I don't think, because Toy Story 1 and 2 hadn't come out in that double Toy Story toy box pack yet. But Monsters, Inc. came out, and of course it had tons of extras, including the entire original film that they shut down, where Boo speaks English, just babble in the movie. And Boo, it has lots of brothers who bully her. So when she goes into the monster world, she likes it. And she becomes a monster scarer like Mike and Sully. And it's a whole different script. And guess what? They threw it away and they started over. And they made Boo younger. And she doesn't talk. And that's where the heart and soul of the movie really came to life. It's not cynical in any way. The original one is cynical. You know, a young girl is bullied, so she in turn becomes a bully by being a monster and eliciting screams from young children. But the finished product doesn't have any of that. You know, these two monsters truly care for this child. It's a tour de force, again, of a great storytelling. With Steve Buscemi as the villain, Randall, the winds of change are coming. I mean, great, great stuff. James Coburn as Waternoose, Jennifer Tilly as Mike's girlfriend, Smoopy Poo. Great. And needless to say, the door sequence at the end is stunning. Up until that point, it was the greatest animated sequence I'd ever seen. The door chase is mind-bogglingly good because, and I'll tell you why, from a writing standpoint, they tell you the rules, how you go through the doors to get to other places. And then they have a chase involving those doors where you can go into them and come out other doors and this and that. And the reason it's good is they've told you how it works. And then they put it in action. And it doesn't, at no point do you go, oh, that's ridiculous. No. You buy it hook, line, and sinker up until Boo's door is shredded. And then you cry like a baby because Sully can't get to her anymore if the door is shredded. Fantastic movie. Monsters, Inc. And again, this is our first fully organic movie where the big breakthrough on Monsters, Inc. was Sully's fur. Because they'd never been able to do fur like that would behave normal and real, you know? And Mike, the wide-eyed, one-eyed optimist, I'm on TV, you know? So good. Such a fantastic movie. We bought into it. And here's where the DreamWorks and Pixar Disney battle finally comes to the consumer. Because I remember that the day, now movies, new movies are released. They were on VHS and on DVD now and Blu-ray and digitally, always come out on a Tuesday. They're Tuesday releases. That was set by the studios, so they were 3 or 4 days, 3 days from the Friday. It's as far as you can get from the Friday box office before and the Friday box office to come, so that video releases don't affect the box office of new movies, which is the bread and butter, right? Well, DreamWorks, the same day that Monsters, Inc. was released to theaters, Shrek was released on VHS and DVD. Stores had huge displays subtly hinting that for less than the price of one movie ticket, you could take Shrek home and have a party and watch it. And I went, those crafty guys at DreamWorks, and you know it's Katzenberg trying to steal thunder from the Disney Corporation, changing the release date of home entertainment from Tuesday to Friday to directly interfere with the Monsters, Inc. box office. Now, Monsters, Inc. would go on to, again, like Toy Story 2 before it, become the biggest animated movie of all time. They were every big release that came out would make more money than the one before it. Monsters, Inc. made a ton of money. Would it have made more if they hadn't released Shrek on the same day? Maybe. I don't know. But these were must-see movies on the big screen. And again, remember, Monsters, Inc. is 2001. These are still movies on film. They're not digital yet. The first commercial digital film did not come out until the year after, which was Attack of the Clones. And even then, only in a few, very few select theaters that had been equipped with a digital projector. That wouldn't happen for 2 or 3 more years. They would still deliver the film in a big canister. And Monsters, Inc. was no different. And I just knew Disney was going to build a roller coaster, a hanging roller coaster where you were on a door. so you could experience the chase scene at the end. They never did, which really shocked me. They would eventually remove Superstar Limo from Mike and Sully's escape at California Adventure, but that's just an overlay based on what the existing ride was. And it's a brilliant overlay, but it's not that exhilarating door chase that I thought we were going to get. I mean, it is ripe for a roller coaster. It should be a premier e-ticket, almost indoor roller coaster with projections of all the monster characters, you know, trying to grab you as you try to escape. Imagine how great that would be. And I know they must have had storyboards on it from day one. I'm not naive enough to think that I'm the guy thinking of that. But maybe it was deemed that a movie like Monsters, Inc., which is made for small children, should have a ride that small children can ride. So I totally get that. I totally understand that. So we're going to wrap it up. That's Monsters, Inc. 2001 with our look at the movies of Pixar. We will pick up the next episode with the next release. It would take 2 years for Finding Nemo to enter theaters. We will talk about going to see that, the effect that it had, how good it is, and the future of Pixar on the next episode of 91 Reasons.
Thanks for listening to 91 Reasons. Please subscribe and leave a review on iTunes. Find us on Facebook. Is anyone even still listening?
'Buzzball. So why don't you make like a tree and get out of here?